So hello, everybody. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's wonderful to be in these kinds of contexts where it's a very specific theme. We can all kind of gather around and isolate our focus. It's a little bit of the gold standard of the academic environment. So I'm looking forward to geeking out pretty hard over the next couple of days. Chad and I are conducting some work on the Brisbane G20 political summit. In particular, we are looking at a larger project that examines a number of dimensions at that event to do with the overall total security apparatus. For this particular focus, we are examining the a number of specific strategies and mechanisms for regulating flows during major events, and in particular in the context of the public order policing environment. That entails both regulating urban flows, the idea of regulating people, objects, things as they move through urban space, but also looking at surveillance, situational awareness, and the way that information and intelligence itself is leveraged within the urban environment, but also how it moves internally, how the organizations and the apparatus themselves manage information flows. So our inspiration for the frame for the work comes through what is now a sort of familiar way to understand flows within urban environments and particularly for surveillance, drawing on Foucault's security territory population lectures, where we understand public order policing as the control of a series of circulations that can be identified through strategies of surveillance. We use the term situational awareness there. You'll see why that's relevant. And looking at the various ways that flows are disciplined, tamed, some of them are excluded, separated into good, bad, and the number of measures that might range from hard exclusionary measures to more soft measures. So the idea that liberty is not the opposite of security, but liberty itself could be understood as a regulation of a particular kind of flow. So we're going to move to the punchline first.
So our paper today really has three key themes that tend to overlap, and they've been extracted from the comparative studies that we've done, focusing on the Brisbane G20, looking back, particularly back to the Toronto 2010 G20. So the three key themes here, police seem to be securing territories at these events in very similar ways, the way in which they regulate and control urban environments. But it's localised with a whole different sets of nuances and tensions. And one in particular is this idea of look and feel and how that plays out in different ways. We'll touch on that in some detail later on. Police tactics seem to be evolving considerably in relation to public order policing, involving more negotiation and engagement with protest groups or issue-motivated groups at the same time as enhanced intelligence and surveillance, which suggests that there is a blurring of boundaries between the ideal types of negotiated management and strategic incapacitation, which we suggest needs to be understood further in specific contexts, given particularly that negotiated management as an ideal type tries to discourage intelligence and surveillance gathering. Our data suggests that it's an essential part of it. And third, and most interestingly also, is that the police are seemingly adapting their own systems and processes, particularly around command and control, involving what we consider to be a decentralized decision-making structure, but still trying to centralize information management, which is designed largely to better enable them to manage the internal flows, the extensive flows of data and information, but having some flexibility to provide rapid responses to uncertain flows around risky populations. In network language, we might understand that as kind of like a hub and spoke network, but one that the hub performs different functions and pushes back different functions to those constituent nodes around it.
Okay, so there are two dominant paradigms to understand, or sort of theoretical frameworks to understand public order policing within the policing studies literature. The first looks at negotiated management, second, strategic incapacitation. These are trying to identify characteristics of how police respond to public disorder in urban environments. Negotiated management refers to a sort of mandated cooperation between police and protest groups, such that police can preempt and negotiate aspects to do with the protest, so that you'll have information collected on when it will occur, how long it will occur, where it will take place. And this is something that was emergent in the 1970s, largely after some concerns about escalated force and high use of violence at protest events. Now, after 1999 in Seattle, the Battle of Seattle that many of us would remember, the event itself was completely shut down. That sort of triggered a new era of public order policing. Law enforcement wanted to distinguish between transgressive protesters and those that would remain within the lawful bounds of negotiated management, given the fact that the negotiated management style was completely overloaded and short-circuited. So there was the emergence of a new set of tactics that, of course, would ride on the crest of a number of changes after 9/11, enhanced technological capacity, broader trends around information sharing, and that would also coincide with the establishment of physical barriers within the urban environment, because negotiated management could no longer be relied upon to tame flows. So some of our purpose here was to try and think this literature through a little bit more within the context of circulations and within the context of flows. And our data, actually, when we get into looking at the territory, but then also examining the populations, will pull on these dominant frameworks a little bit further.
So to give you a little bit of an idea about the security operation itself for the 2014 G20. It was held in November last year in Brisbane, Queensland, which is a small city in northern Australia. Prior meetings were held in Cairns, which is an even smaller city at the top of Australia, and Sydney. The security operation itself involved close to 6,500 police from around Australia as well as New Zealand, and many other agencies, including, of course, security, intelligence, defence, and the private sector. For those of you unfamiliar with policing in Australia, we are a little bit unique compared to the North American context in that we have state police and no city or municipality police. So the numbers of agencies are much smaller. We have about 7 key police agencies that police the whole country. But as a consequence, they are substantially larger. The legislation that was introduced for the event, two real key pieces, the G20 Safety and Security Act, and that was accompanied by regulations. The regulations designated certain spaces that were to be secured and in particular ways. Our data here is based essentially on qualitative interviews, as well as the analysis of key documents. One was just sent to us very recently, a post-event evaluation. The data set for the larger project involves interviews with many agency representatives and stakeholders, where we've actually got to speak to them about what they did and what lessons they found and what sort of challenges they were confronted with. Today we're focusing only on the interviews with the Queensland Police Service, which is the jurisdiction responsible for policing in the state of Queensland, and they formed a specified G20 group, which was responsible for planning and organising the security operation for the G20.
Okay, so in terms of policing circulations within the urban environment, this is very familiar for many of you that were either at the student protests here, but also within Toronto, a now established method of erecting physical barriers to try and separate and divide space and regulate access into various zones. This map here shows a map of Brisbane. The red area is an external security zone. The blue dots here are specific buildings where events specific to the summit would take place, restricted areas. And then there was also another sort of third enclosure that would take place along transport ways. They were delimited temporally, so that you would have them established, authorized by a single official, and then removed. And taken together, this would be a way to separate, splinter, control the space. And critical geographers have been on this stuff for a while, Stephen Graham, Francisco Clauser, looking at the idea of passage point urbanism. Now, what happens, what's quite interestingly with this legal and spatial separation, is that legislation would be passed to authorize new powers to compel visibility within these spaces. So that would either be new ways to normalize and discipline the space, but it would be significantly leveraged to try and render flows increasingly transparent through technological means, so the use of surveillance within the physical architecture itself, but also for compelling identities amongst people that would move through these areas. So increased stop and search powers, enhanced accreditation to be able to access within a specific area. The idea of sort of bans and prohibiting specific items from coming into the areas. And this was, by and large, being used as a way to, basically just to render the flows visible and control the mobility of flows themselves. Also, interestingly, with the physical delineations, such as extensive fencing, this is a common trend, but what was really quite interesting in the wake of Toronto, where the event was a significant spectacle, there was a concerted effort on behalf of organizers who had liaised extensively with Toronto to actually try and make things different. So the idea of reflexive adaptations is that when we see from event to event, the regulation, there's sort of this continuity, but also step changes and trying to mark the ways in which certain events would trigger a transformation in regulating flows the next time. One of those particular changes was to do with the optics, but to do with the look and feel of the event. One of our interviewees mentioned that they lobbied for a polycarbonate fence so that it was clear enough for them to see through into the crowd and try and identify any danger that might be approaching the fence, but it was also intended to soften the feel so that individuals who were at the event could look inside, see Obama and see Putin, and they didn't have to feel as though there was this sort of explicit fortress. So there's a concealing of the apparatus, but also of at least its forceful presence is still felt. And some of this actually comes down to work from, or theoretical work with Sloterdijk, the idea of regulating the atmosphere of flows themselves.
So with regard to the policing of populations, we've looked extensively at the activities that led into the event, looking back for approximately 24 months from the moment the Queensland Police Service started to actually think about how they were going to go about this security operation. Then the next slide will talk about what some of the things, key features that happened during the event. So the legislation that was created encouraged, but it deliberately didn't compel issue-motivated groups or protest groups to contact a designated police liaison officer well in advance of the event to negotiate details of their proposed protest. So what they were protesting about, when they were going to protest, what sort of media attention they wanted, what was their time frame, what location was their preference, etc. extensive lesson drawing on part of QPS, Queensland Police Service, largely from Toronto 2010, but they travelled extensively around the world leading up to this event, led them to conclude that effective engagement with issue-motivated groups is essential to planning an event, as well as probably the key for them to preventing unlawful and violent protests. At the same time, though, they weren't going to rely on engagement alone. The risks were too great. So extensive intelligence operations were also conducted. They involved developing a threat matrix based on intent and capability for protest groups, detailing a series of key indicators. And these threat matrices would also assist QPS in their approach to negotiating with each group. So they would know details about their history, their leadership, their structure, their prior activities. But also some of the key themes with protest groups is this idea of leaderless groups, which was a classic theme coming out of the Seattle protest. So they were of the view that intelligence was essential to actually working out who exactly to negotiate with, let alone how to negotiate. Our interviewees, as the quotes suggest there, spoke repeatedly about the importance of negotiated management and what they call relationship building in encouraging good flows whilst also protecting against the risks of bad flows. So during the event itself, the security operation was overlaid with an immensely complex command and control structure that was both multi-layered and quite intentionally dispersed, as well as an intelligence and surveillance apparatus that needed to manage the input and output of extensive data and information flows. One of the key challenges we've had in putting the paper together for this is actually working out how to do justice to the theme. So we've concluded that we're going to have to narrow our focus a little bit, and it may be more on the intelligence frameworks and the flows that are occurring in this context. But a POC, a Police Operations Centre, was also created, and that was built from the ground up, brand new, because it was the event was too big to cater for the size of the infrastructure that QPS already had. It was referred to as a central nervous system or a single source of truth, with advanced situational awareness over all territories. So the territories that we spoke about earlier were under constant surveillance. There were cameras, there was helicopters, unmanned drones at different points in time. All data feed was linking into the POC, which had isolated areas inside that would display data feeds based on functionality, which is quite a unique feature about a police operations center. If you've ever been in one before, normally it's just a big wall that's got cameras going up all over the place. Well, Queensland actually decided to carve out space within the POC so that the data feed that you were seeing was relevant to your role and what you did, and you weren't getting confused by everything else that was on display. At the same time, there was a joint intelligence group, a JIG, also referred to as a single source of truth, but for intelligence, that operated alongside the POC to coordinate intelligence flows. So the JIG was a multi-agency setup that had around eight intelligence agencies that were part of its core framework. They had alongside that a JAG, a joint analyst group, that would then analyze any intelligence that was being shared amongst the JIG. From that, there were also field intelligence officers, and they were deployed in and amongst crowds, having body cameras and just doing covert surveillance, as is custom in these kinds of events. And they were deployed to collect human intelligence that would then be relayed back into the POC, but also the JIG. Police actively encouraged local decision making during the event, and there are a number of reasons for this. Initially, they cited significant learning from Toronto 2010, where some of the feedback they were getting from the key organisers from the Toronto G20 was that a lot of the problems when they started. Police on the ground wanted to do something about it to try to perhaps curtail it, calm the situation down or control it earlier, whatever that may be. But they were relaying information back to the POC, which was the central decision-making body, and they weren't getting decisions made quickly enough, or they weren't getting the decisions made that they wanted. So Brisbane made a deliberate effort to push decision-making down to the ground, so that if police were there at a particular location, they saw something that needed to be responded to, they were responsible for deciding how it would be responded to at that time, in that moment, rather than going back to the POC, which was interesting because even though the POC itself had enormous amounts of situational awareness with the cameras and data feeds, etc., they did feel that the best people to make the decisions were the ones on the ground. And there was a whole structure of command and control around that. There were more senior police deployed on the ground rather than having lower ranking officers. And the other reason we suggest that this sort of structure was implemented was just because they weren't able to manage the sheer volume of information flows. That if every request for a decision was coming back to the POC, you can see how quickly a POC is able to be overloaded with information. Police also enhanced responsiveness through pre-staged resources, which was quite interesting. By having such delicate control of the territories, you were able to anticipate and respond to flows of protest groups, where they were going, how they were moving, etc., and they would have police response teams strategically located, often hidden away, while the protesters were moving along their designated paths, so that if anything did happen or if any risks were able to, they did arise, they were able to respond to them in real time through rapid response teams. But having said all of that, the event itself was largely a non-event in the sense of a public order policing operation. Very few people have heard about the Brisbane G20 because nothing actually happened. And we've looked at this and tried to really understand why. And a point that Benoit made earlier about the Montreal weather, well, come to Brisbane and you'll have a 46 degree day and try to run a series of protesters in that environment, and it was really referred to in the media as water bottle diplomacy to the extent that police were handing out water bottles to protesters most of the day because they were worried about people fainting and therefore needing ambulances. So we don't know, and we'll never know, to what extent the engagement, relationship building, the policing actually prevented anything from happening or not. But there are a number of reasons why protests don't happen, and the weather and external factors are certainly just as important. So we can leave it there for questions.